In this presentation, we explore the six terms that are central to folklore studies and examine how they let us imagine the way everyday people like you and me not only make our way through the world, but make the world itself. The six terms are not terribly fancy. Competence, performance, text, context, genre, and tradition. And you probably heard some or all of them before. But what we are going to explore today is how they can be used to describe the dynamic nature of culture itself, and that we can do that with a fair degree of precision, with just six words. I'll begin with a little bit of a thought experiment. Imagine you're in the library and you're a little bit lost, and you come across this guy, and you want to ask him a question about where to find something. Maybe you're looking for a particular section of the library, maybe you're looking for a particular item, whatever it is, you're lost, you need some help, and you come across this guy, and he looks friendly enough, doesn't he? And so you go to ask him a question, and he looks up at you, and for a moment, you think to yourself, oh, he didn't understand my question. Or maybe you wonder, does he even speak English? And so what you're drawn to wonder is he a competent speaker of English? That is, can he understand English, and can he speak English? That is, can he make a sentence in English? Is he competent at it? And so one of the key terms in folklore studies is competence, and all competence means is the ability to do something. Can you make a sentence in English? And how do you know someone can make a sentence in English? This is not a tricky question. This is an obvious question. You know they can make a sentence in English when they perform that for you. That is, when we ask that person a question, excuse me, sir, where's the reference section? And he responds, it's over there. We know that he not only can understand our question, but he can respond to it in a way that we understand. And we only understand that competence when he performs it for us. But the question is, how did that competence get inside his head? That is, how did he get to be a competent speaker of English? Here's the trick. Your first response might be, well, he went to school. School is where we learn things. School is where we learn proper English. And yet, that isn't the answer to the question. That isn't where our competence in speakers of English begins. In fact, our competence as speakers of English begins far earlier than that. Our competence as speakers of English begins when we are but babies. It begins because as we lie there in our cribs or toddle around on our houses, people are talking to us. Maybe they're saying some crazy things, things that we say that we no longer talk to babies, things like goo goo gaga, because that's what babies say. But in fact, what most adults are saying is, are you hungry? Are you hungry? Oh, what a cute baby. Oh, do you see the moon? There's the moon, right? What are adults doing? Oh, they're performing English or whatever language they're speaking today, but they're performing speech for the baby. And the baby slowly begins to put together what these different sounds mean. The adults say this word ball, and this round object appears in front of me. So slowly I begin to understand that ball, right? And you hear words, right? Babies are good at first grabbing onto nouns, the objects that are in their lives. Then they're good at putting together verbs, what objects do in their lives. Then slowly the other pieces of grammar begin to fall into place. And pretty soon kids are only 3 or 4 years old, and they're putting together perfectly serviceable sentences in whatever language their family and community speaks. And it all got there through performance. So how you come to understand how to speak English, in fact, arguably how you come to understand how to do almost anything, is by listening and watching other people do it. And so you then can do it. And that is, how do we know that you can do it? We do it because you then do it yourselves. And so there's this dynamic relationship between competence and performance. And the way maybe you say things, having learned things from your parents, now you pass it on to your children or to others around you. Or maybe you say things slightly differently. Maybe you have a slightly idiosyncratic approach, and that is enough to affect other people's performances. So these become things that are very much linked in tension, they're dynamic. But I think we need to think a little bit more about one of those terms, and that's performance. Because there's a lot going on. So if you think about the baby in their space, in their house, how do you know as a kid, how do you know even as a student what to pay attention to, right? If you're in a classroom normally, or even here, you're sitting in front of your screen, you're watching the computer, the text seems obvious, right? The thing that you're supposed to pay attention to seems obvious. It is me here talking. The text of this presentation is me talking. But think of all the things you're not paying attention to, all the things that are also going on. Perhaps it's your computer screen is flickering a little bit. Perhaps you have a sibling or a child or a partner somewhere in the background making noise. Somebody just flushed the toilet. You're trying to pay attention, and there's all these other things going on in the background that are the context. Now, sometimes those things are things we can easily ignore, but sometimes they aren't things we can ignore. But at any rate, all these things go together to understand, so we understand what to focus on and what not to focus on. So text is that which we pay attention to, and context is that which we ignore. But even as I was talking about paying attention to me talking, and I mentioned the other people in your house, or other people in the room, wherever you happen to be, perhaps how uncomfortable that chair is, or how long you've been hunched over your computer. However that is, for a moment, you were drawn to think about that. And maybe, just maybe, you stopped paying attention to what I was saying, and you started paying attention to other things, the context. And then what happens is you are paying attention to that, and that becomes the text for you. And me talking slipped into the background and became a context for some other part of your experience. And so we need to think about the fact that there is this relationship between text and context, and that it seems obviously what's text and what's context when it's a university professor talking either into a microphone and you're listening in some part of your house, or you're in a classroom, but it's less obvious perhaps when we're all gathered together and talking, right? When a bunch of people start talking at once, who do you pay attention to? What becomes the focus of your attention? And what we're doing? How do you know what we're doing? Right? So we have to think about the relationship between those two things, and that is that they are dynamic, that we're always negotiating who's talking to some degree. We're negotiating what we're talking about. And that all these things are part of a performance. And so there's can be an individual text and its context in which it fits, and there can be a larger performance in which there are multiple texts that are all fitting into a context. And being able to understand the relationship between a given text and a given context is part of our competence. Now, that's a lot of abstractions. Let me give you an example that might help make things make sense. I'm going to use this picture of a university professor out talking with his students. But let's imagine that you and I meet up somewhere, and have only seen each other through the video screen, but now we're actually seeing each other in person. And so there's a moment of discomfort. We don't really know what to talk about. So what do? We talk about general things. Maybe, oh, it looks like it's going to rain today. Oh, I don't know. Maybe it's been kind of hot lately. I don't know. Well, have you seen the traffic on Johnston Street? That was kind of crazy. Yeah. And then let's say somebody else joins us and they say, hey guys, what are you doing? You turn to that person and what do you say? You say, oh, we're just chit-chatting, we're just talking, we're just passing the time. These are all ways we have of saying that this kind of talk we're engaging in is fairly general, fairly non-committed, and maybe that person goes, oh, hey, this just happened to me. And so they tell us a story of an event that just happened in their life. And pretty soon, one of us is drawn to say, you know, that reminds me of something that happened to me. And soon we're telling little bits of stories about our lives that are fairly lightweight and anecdotal. And someone else walks up and joins us. And now there's four of us there. And that person says, what are you guys doing? And we say something like, well, we're just swapping stories. Oh, they say, and they know exactly what we're doing. And maybe that person's a little bit of a trickster. I have a friend who's really good at telling jokes and can think of a joke for every occasion. And maybe they start telling jokes and that reminds somebody else of a joke. And pretty soon we're passing jokes we've known back and forth. And somebody else walks up. Now there's five of us standing around. And that fifth person says, what are you guys doing? And we say, well, we're telling jokes. Do you understand how we're all still talking? We're all passing text back and forth. But as we've changed text, the context for what we're doing has also changed. And so there's this fifth term we now need to think about, and that's genre, right? Genre is simply a word that means kinds of things. It's related to genus. And so genre is not simply that stuff you learned in literature classes where this is lyric poetry versus epic poetry, this is, you know, a comedy versus a tragedy versus something else. This is every day we are making genre distinctions. We live by genre. There are certain kinds of stories we tell that we tell only with our friends. And there are certain kinds of stories we tell only with our family. Now, some of these are topical matters, but some of these are kinds of stories. Forms that we tell. Topic and form can be interrelated here. And so genre is one way of thinking about our human relationships. That is, there are certain stories you only tell your partner or best friend. And to tell them to anybody else would perhaps be too revealing. And there are stories that you share with your general set of friends. And there are stories you share with acquaintances. You have all these gradations of stories in your mind, right? Each of us already has a handful of stories that we readily tell when first introducing ourselves to someone else. And that means that genre is always operating. It is always operating in our brains, and it's always operating in the background behind this dynamic. Every moment that we are talking, we are making generic distinctions. We're always trying to think about genre. And genre is interesting because there's so much dynamic, things that come into and out of it. And what's more important is that genres are always changing, just like competence and performance are always changing. And as we layer those things up and we think about what's changed across time, we get to that sixth term now that makes up our essential terms in folklore studies, and that's tradition. Tradition is the way that folklorists have of talking about things that pass through space and time, right? Stories that move through time, that stick around, are stories, and they move from person to person or group to group. They are stories that have a kind of stability to them, a kind of ability to keep addressing situations in new ways, but they remain themselves. In other cases, there are genres that arise to address particular moments and genres that disappear as those moments pass. That's part of the sort of dynamism of folklore. It comes and goes as needed, and then there are some things that stick around. And what's really interesting is the way that this all works. So there are some genres that cross paths and they change communities. And sometimes genres merge together and form entirely new genres. And as this diagram points out, some genres go on undisturbed, they spin off new genres, and some genres simply stop where they are. Now, there are a couple of ways to think about space as well in all this. So tradition clearly applies to time. It applies to space to somewhat, right? Those things that can spread widely obviously have a kind of something more universal to them than things that only stay in a local area. But let's think about competence. Because each of us has more than one kind of competence, right? Each of us possesses a host of anecdotes, a host of jokes. We know that which anecdotes to tell, which jokes to tell. We also have other competences. Maybe you're a good cook. Maybe you are particularly good at making certain kinds of other things. Maybe you're good at woodworking. Maybe you're good at quilting. Whatever those things are, you're good at it. And so you have this competence, this ability, these multiple competencies that all go inside your head. This is all those things that make you, right? You are a collection of competences. And just as importantly, there is a kind of communal aspect to this, and you've heard folklorists talk a lot about community, and we'll talk more about that. And that is, there is something that everybody can do. Everybody's expected to do this. I remember one time I was in the grocery store here in Lafayette, and there were two women talking, and they were talking about this man, and he was receiving glowing reviews by these two women, and then one turned to the other and said, "Well, you know, he can't dance." And that was clearly the end of the discussion about that man. So we are all not only able to have competences, all of us are variously competent at those things, but more importantly, we all have a variety of competences. And one of the things that we can think about is that culture is simply this collective competence. Folklorists might look at these things as sort of individual things. They might sort of pierce through and sort of slice through and look for just for anecdotes or just jokes. Or they might look at the sort of aggregate number of things that people have in common. And more importantly, it's how we get through the world. It's how we move from one place to another. It's how when we encounter someone else, we are able to share information. And in sharing information, we actually build community. It's how we know that we are on the same page, right? Context means, right? If you and I talk past each other, we say, "Oh, we're not on the same page." We don't, that is, you and I haven't shared context. You think something else is going on. But when we share context, when we're on the same page, when we understand each other, then we have proceeded to have an effective communication. And there are other people out there, and we might go on to have other kinds of conversations. And that's how we move around the world. And being able to do all this and having all these things is something that the rhetorician Kenneth Burke once called equipment for living. That is, each of us has a store of anecdotes we readily tell, anecdotes we tell to only friends, anecdotes we only tell to our closest friends, jokes we tell to a mixed audience, jokes we only tell to certain kinds of audiences, dishes we make for anybody, dishes we only make for best friends, for lovers, family members, perhaps only dishes we make for children, right? All these things are equipment in our heads, resources in our minds, abilities we have. They are our toolboxes that we carry around in our brains that makes it possible for us to negotiate the world. That is, folklore is not simply, or culture if you prefer, is not simply this stuff that kind of lies around, but it's in fact how we make our way through the world. It is in fact how we construct our world. And this is the notion of the construction of social reality. After all, each and every day, we all have to get up and somehow make things happen in our world. And we do that with the stuff that that's in our toolbox. So let's return to our guy in the library. We've asked him that question. And how do we know he can answer our question? Well, the answer is, we know when he answers the question. But how he answers is complicated, and it may depend on how we asked. All these complex things, competence, performance, text, context, genre, and tradition, these are all vital components that go into almost every social transaction we conduct when we're free to do them. And we'll talk more about that freedom and how that plays into the way folklorists think about the world and approaching those things that they think are most interesting to from a folkloric point of view a little later in the semester. Until then, thank you for your attention.